Hello and welcome. My name is Bob Tickleman. I'm a Microsoft technical trainer, and I'm here to inform you on today's session of what you want to know when you want to know it. We're going to be looking at designing Microsoft Azure infrastructure solutions as part of the AZ-305 course. In this module, we're going to be looking at data integration solutions. And when you take a look at big data, and that's a term that you've probably heard thrown around, we've got all these different repositories of data, and we've covered in other modules, whether it be unstructured data, whether it be lightly structured data of MongoDB or Cassandra or Cosmos DB, Azure tables, for that lightly name value paired data storage that we're dealing with, all the way up to our highly structured data. Now we incorporate things like IoT devices. There's this broad range of data that's available for us. And you'll often hear about a thing called a data estate. What does our data estate look like? And while they are standalone repositories, businesses are looking for ways to bring all that information together into this thing called their data estate. And then having ways to take all of that big data and analyze it collectively. And so you're going to take a look at these series of services that are available to take that data in whatever storage location it is and bringing it into a common repository. And you'll see these terms of what is a data factory and what is a data lake. And maybe I need to do some transform. And so we'll introduce you to a term called ETL, extract, transform, and load. Or you can even change the order of those letters. But we'll take a look at all of these characteristics that Azure provides for you to take your data in its individual repositories, bringing it together into a single data estate, and find ways to make that information available for different analytic tools that you're working with. So let's get into the lesson. When you take a look at this new modern world, when we talk about big data and data warehouses and data estates, and they're terms that get thrown around a lot, we just want to know from an architect's perspective the concepts that you need to build into your solution. So I just want to touch on a couple of major concepts within this whole world of large or big data itself. And so we're going to introduce some of these terms. I'm not going to get deep into what they are and how you're going to, or what the solution is that they're going to do for you, but hopefully inform you as an architect so that you can either rule something in or out of a solution. When you take a look at data-driven workflows, and anytime I deal with a large amount of data, we want to try and automate as much of this as we possibly can. There's also a couple of acronyms that you're going to hear through this, and the common one is ETL, or extract, transform, and load. It is a set of processes to extract data from one location, perform some transformation against it to get it into a format so that you could load it in that format into a usable, consumable manner for the next stage to deal with. And so what we want to take a look at is I'm going to start with a big picture here, and I'm going to come back and take a look at these data-driven workflows. What I have for you is a sample of how we take data from a wide variety of sources, and you're seeing that here in the upper left-hand corner. I've got a wide variety of sources that come from the lightly structured data of things like Cosmos DB and Azure tables, Redis caches, from JSON documents. We have our unstructured data that comes from maybe a blob storage with images and document files that are in there. I might have highly structured data coming from SQL or SQL hyperscale. So you're seeing this full range of data types being represented. And we bring this information into a data factory. I then need to take that information and bring it into some common set of storage. And this is where we're going to get this extract, transform, and load, because I need to have a workflow that then takes this information in its various formats and puts it in a format that I'm going to be able to work with this. And so what you're seeing here with data-driven workflows is you can orchestrate the data movement from where it's coming from, its original source location, into an Azure data factory. So you're seeing that in this example right here. Our data factory just becomes that common repository that I got to get the data into the data factory, and then I need to perform some processes to it to be able to consume that later on. And so it's going to orchestrate the data movement and then transform that data at scale. And so what we have are these things called pipelines that you can develop that will take that data and automate that process. I'm here to talk to you today about Azure Architecture and specifically about designing a data integration solution with Azure Data Lake. Azure Data Lake is a form of large-scale storage. You're going to see that it's a type of storage account that I can create. We're going to do a compare and contrast against an Azure blob storage that you're working with. It's a comprehensive scale capability that is very similar to the concepts that we introduced when we talked about an Azure storage account for blob storage. So previously we saw that we have a wide variety of data in its original source of truth location. We then had a data factory, as a factory typically does. It manufactures something through a set of pipelines. It extracts that data and needs to deposit it into this Azure Data Lake storage location. It's from here that we now have all of this dissimilar information in a common repository for you to be able to then potentially mine that information for use within an application. When you compare an Azure Data Lake versus Azure Blob Storage, as I described, it's very similar that it's this large scale, very highly scalable, highly redundant storage location, and it has the capability of storing a lot of unstructured data. So you're seeing that characteristic of the blob storage. And it stores large volumes of text data as well as other types of data, whether it's coming from structured or lightly structured data. It supports a hierarchical namespace, and this is going to be one of the differences that it has between the Azure Blob Storage itself. Azure Blob Storage provides flat namespaces, and I'll do a demonstration in a bit. I'm going to show you an Azure Blob Storage, and I'm going to convert it to an Azure Data Lake Storage. Or when you create it, it can be created as a Data Lake Storage, and it has this... It makes this change to the object that certain features like automatic backups in Azure Blob Storage are not there because of this hierarchical name structure that it supports with. A lot of similarities from security perspective. We got RBAC controls and the SAS tokens that we have. We got a lot of that same capability with the Azure Data Lake, but now I bring in these access control lists, which is that traditional method of access control lists with access control entries to be able to give grant permissions for the data within that information store. I'm going to be talking today about Azure Architecture and specifically looking at designing a data integration and analytics solution using Azure Databricks. Before I get into what a Databricks is, we want to understand where it fits in the overall position. But basically, it's a fully managed service to manage big data and machine learning platforms to be able to consume that data to do the next activity. You might have seen me use this diagram previously, but when we take a look at your entire data solutions that you have in the upper left-hand corner, we've got a wide variety of data sources, and whether it's coming from my file systems, my MongoDBs, Cosmos DB, whether it be lightly structured, highly structured, or unstructured data, we get all of these different types of data. We bring them through a process that you might hear called ETL, where we've got to extract that information from its original location using a thing called a pipeline. So we build a pipeline through Data Factory to store that information into our data lake storage. Now we have a common repository to be able to query that data and take the volume of data and be able to cherry pick the specific components that I need out of that information. And so I need to be able to then generate a data brick of information from the data lake storage that has all of the components that I'm going to need to be able to pass off to something like Synapse Analytics or to provide reporting generation. And so on a regular basis, I need to automate this process. And so that's what you're looking at here is added, it's a fully managed service that allows you to create a grouping of information from your big data sources and be able to pass that information off to the next stage to actually have that information processed. It doesn't take it out of the data lake necessarily. It's still in there for other processes. And so, in fact, certain types of information might exist in multiple bricks being consumed at different end services consuming that information. I'm going to be talking today about Azure architecture and specifically designing a data integration and analysis solution using Azure Synapse Analysis. Within Azure, we provide a wide variety of tools, both industry standards, some specific to Microsoft, and others that are widely used across the industry. And that is no different across all of Azure. In other modules, we've covered some of this big data model that we've talked about. And so you're going to see some overlap as we go with this. But Azure Synapse Analytics provides for a Synapse implementation and a full set of tools to provide for big data analysis, visualization into a single service. And it brings it all together into, you know, if you've got Spark, you might have heard of terms like Hadoop that are out there. All of these pieces come together into a single utility that you could provide for all of the tools that you might need for your big data warehouse and big data estate management. So you can see that it provides data warehousing, it provides analytical services, and we're going to dive into specific components that will cover this. It provides for real-time analytical services, it provides for data integration, as well as some machine learning of the information itself. When you take a look at the components of Synapse Analytics, there's the Synapse SQL pools that you will then provision for the storage of the information that you're working with. You've got your Spark pools. You've got your Synapse pipelines, similar to the pipelines that we've had for the movement and automation of that movement of that data for potentially taking it from one location, transforming it, and then loading it. You take a look at Synapse Links. And Synapse Studio is a suite of tools to be able to use across the entire platform. So what kind of analysis can you do with Azure Synapse? They talk about four different areas specifically that once you've got your data into the system, you want to find out, you know, what is happening. So you can do near real-time analysis against the information. So you can also take a look at diagnostic information of why is it happening and do comparative against, you know, other services, because, you know, if you have something going wrong, that's one thing, but it might not be the problem. It might be just symptomatic of a deeper problem that you need to take a look at. You can also do some look aheads with predictive analysis of, you know, what is likely to happen based around some known situations. We can predict what might be coming next, as well as we can have a prescriptive analysis of what might need to be done for the next step to potentially stop a potential what might happen from happening. The next couple of slides are going to do a comparison against some other services that you might be familiar with. So taking a look at Azure Data Factory, which I mentioned at the beginning here, which was a utility that we can use to take and extract information from a wide variety of sources that's available in Azure Synapse. You're seeing this comparison and contrast across the Data Factory capabilities versus Azure Synapse. We have a similar comparison versus, you know, Synapse versus Databricks. We talked about Databricks being able to take from your data warehouse and things like Azure Data Lake Storage, taking that combined set of data and carving out chunks of it. We have Azure Synapse that can do that same configuration. What you're going to see is from the Databricks, it's optimized for your Apache Sparks environments you're dealing with, where Synapse is going to use distributed T-SQL. If you go back a couple of slides, we talked about a lot of that data is going to be loaded into SQL pools that you're working with. So you got your T-SQL that you can work with. It deals with your Spark environments. So a compare and contrast against the Databricks. I'm going to be talking today about Azure architecture and specifically designing Azure Stream Analytics solutions for data analysis. When you take a look at the large volumes of data, especially in real time or near real time that are being produced specifically around IoT devices, we don't want to potentially have to have that delay of having that information sit idle in some type of repository, have to go through some processing to get it into a data factory and then through to a data lake storage to be able to consume it as a data brick. So Azure Stream Analytics provides a real-time or near real-time analytics and provides some complex event processing against that data stream that you might be taking a look at. And so you're seeing on the slide here is starting from the far left-hand side is a process to be able to ingest that information, as I said, in real time and provide some analytical information against maybe point of sales or IoT devices you're working with it. It provides click analytics from your website. Again, you know, a wide variety of information for us to be able to take that information in, provide some analytical service, and then do some predictive analysis and delivery of that information to a data source so that we can go back, take a look at it, and see what has been done based around that information that was delivered to us. I'm going to be talking today about Azure architecture and specifically designing a strategy for hot, warm, and cold data paths. We've been talking about large data and all the different forms of data that we have. We've taken a look at IoT, we've taken a look at events, we've seen messaging. You know, data is everywhere. And what you want to be able to do is when you start looking at data estates and your large volumes of data, you want to be able to categorize or classify data into one of three categories because it can have a significant impact on cost as well as performance depending on how you classify the data. So for example, if you're only worried about near real-time performance of maybe some IoT devices out at the perimeter of, say, some manufacturing plant, you know, you don't need a large volume of data to be stored for historical purposes. Maybe you need to keep records of that. Maybe there's some compliance requirements you're doing. But using that data set for your real-time analytics would then have a significant impact on the performance of that near real-time performance that you're looking for because the data is now considered stale or not relevant anymore. So what you want to be able to do is to classify your data into one of three categories. Your hot data becomes that near real-time. You know, it might be things that are changing frequently. You know, temperatures, the heat within maybe some mechanical device that would indicate failure if it heats up too much. You want to monitor that for its potential changing state. Where something is going to stay in a steady state for a long period of time, you might still need that information because maybe you need to check it periodically and then check it over a period of time to see is it might be trending in a direction, but you can only find that trend by looking at it over a large period of time. So classifying that warm data and then putting it into a tier of storage that doesn't have to have maybe that, you know, high throughput IOPS performance that you might have that costs more money. You might be able to store it in a different storage tier to be able to get better cost performance, but still have the data available for you. So think about these concepts and the classification of your data from a performance perspective and a cost perspective and what the impact is going to be as you generate that data to be classified and then stored for your business needs, either in the near real time or long term. So some of that might have been new for some of you. And there's a whole topic, and we've got a series of courses, not just one, a whole series of courses that talks about a number of those technologies that I mentioned to you. So with that, I want to thank you for participating in this lesson, and I look forward to seeing you at a future one.